crisis that we're now looking at. Ladies and gentlemen, I give you Lyndon H. LaRouche, Jr.
Thank you all. During the recent several years, since 1987, but most visibly since the beginning of 1992, there has been an escalating, hyperbolically spiraling upward bubble of financial speculation centered around the phenomenon of so-called derivatives. During the recent several years, since the phenomenon first became visible during 1992, there has been a rising rate of bankruptcies of governmental and private institutions due to the impact of derivatives speculation. The frequency and the volume of bankruptcy money involved in the bankruptcy has increased over the recent years. There is no sign or possibility under present conditions of this abating. There is a global epidemic of financial, monetary, and economic collapse, which is caused immediately by what are called derivatives. This epidemic will continue either until the patient collapses, that is the world monetary and financial system, or until remedies are introduced, which are equivalent as remedies to the application of Chapter 11 bankruptcy reorganization on a world scale. Until that's happened, the economy will continue to collapse, and nothing can stop it. And above all, the contract with America, which won't stop it, it will accelerate it. Because you cannot solve this problem except by rebuilding the tax revenue base on a per capita, per household, and per area, land area such as state or locality, as well as governmental level. No possibility. We have, therefore, a June conference, which is a significant point of inflection, the so-called Halifax conference. A significant point of inflection in the decision-making process, which presents the world's governments and other institutions as a result of this ongoing epidemic of monetary and financial collapse. If we read the situation around the globe in leading banking and governmental circles, one would say that there are three points of view which are being prepared to be presented within the discussions at the coming June Halifax conference on monetary reform, essentially, or the monetary crisis. One view are the absolute idiots, the fanatics, who refuse to admit that there is an epidemic financial and monetary crisis in progress. Now, this includes or is typified by yuppies in New York City's Wall Street district, who refuse to believe that their computers are not God. Right? And therefore they say, no, this game will go on forever, and nothing can stop it. Other people who are more serious are divided. Publicly, this is very little visible in the United States, this second aspect of the problem, because of our news media. There is very little reflection in public utterances which are widely circulated of the recognition that this kind of global epidemic crisis is in progress and that derivatives has to be crushed. We had recently, under the Democratic Congress, we had Henry Gonzalez, a very lovable, amiable gentleman who is also a bit of a curmudgeon, but who was leading in calling to the attention of the Congress, the government generally, and the American people, the fact that we had a financial speculative process in progress involving the doubtful activities of the Federal Reserve under Greenspan, which were leading to a calamity down the line. Now we have new people who are dominating the Congress. I wouldn't say the Republicans, because the Republicans have got a parasite on their back, which is called neoconservatives. And they are controlled largely by the fact we're now in a 1996 election campaign, and what people say has nothing to do, perhaps, with what they would do in office, but it has a great deal to do with getting money from the money bags to finance their election campaigns, one of the anomalies of our political system. But nonetheless, the people in Washington today, generally, will not, in the Congress, will not admit that the cause of our crisis is a fundamental systemic problem in the financial system and the monetary system, and that a radical change in policies, a reversal of many of the policies introduced over the past 30 years, must be accomplished. Otherwise, there will be no possible recovery from a continued collapse. The views which exist on this matter among those who are sane enough to admit that we have an epidemic of financial disaster sweeping around the world and billowing like a storm. Well, some say yes, there is a crisis. Yes, it is not isolated. It is not a shoe clerk of Barings in Singapore that caused the crisis. It is not the president of Mexico who caused the crisis. It is not this or that explanation. The fact is, the system as a whole is in a crisis and is headed toward the rocks, toward bankruptcy. But, they say, the problem here is not that the system is wrong. The problem is that it has been badly administered, and that if we can get some new faces in there with some appropriate revisions in our policies, our policy practice and leadership, we can probably bring the thing under control. Maybe not cure the disease, but at least manage it. So this becomes the theory of the manageable crisis, which will be very loudly presented during the coming Halifax conference. Now, the third view, which is the actually only sane view, but probably still a minority view, is the understanding that this crisis is not a crisis of administrative, errors, it's not a crisis of management. It is the system as it has developed, especially over the past 30 years and especially the past 25 years. The system as a whole is rotten and must collapse. And the question is whether the people have the brains to get off the sinking Titanic and into the lifeboats. That's the issue. Because there's no way that the human race and this system can continue to cohabit this planet for much longer. There will be, in Europe, you can see there are voices which will debate this question. Is the crisis administrative or systemic? There are a rising number of voices in Europe, as Helga will indicate, which are leaning toward the perception that the crisis is systemic, not administrative. There are people in the United States who are worrying about that, that the crisis might be systemic, not administrative. But they are not much represented in the daily news disinformation media, such as the Washington Post, and so, for example, here. So that's the situation. The problem, the challenge to the policy shapers and policy makers is whether they are going to be dominated by the news media opinion and public opinion polls of a public which in the first place is being lied to massively by the news media. Don't ask what public opinion is, ask what has the news media done to brainwash the public lately. And we have a public which is no longer literate. Our school systems have collapsed over the past 20-odd years, 25 years, nearly 30 years. The student who graduates from a university today is typically not as literate as a secondary school graduate in the middle of the 1960s. So our American people are more poorly informed. Look at our newspapers. Compare the newspapers of today. They were bad then, but compare them today with 20, 30 years ago. Look at the content. Look at them from a cognitive standpoint. Look at the ideas which are popularized by the news media. Look at the increasing influence in this so-called wired-in society of the so-called entertainment media. Look at the television news, which is essentially a branch of the entertainment media and which writes worse fiction than do the probably even the soap operas. And this kind of soap opera entertainment character of CNN and other news broadcasts spills over into the print media. You can go through most of the United States and pick up the local newspaper, and you will find difficulty in finding any news at all in that newspaper, if you know what the news is. It's simply a slapdash. So the American people are misinformed. Their attention spans are shorter than they were 20 or 30 years ago. This corresponds to the collapse of the skill level of productive operatives in the economy and a shrinking of the percentile of the total labor force, which has productive skills as we understood them back 30 years ago. So opinion is largely manipulated, public opinion, by the news media. And so when the news media takes a poll, it's looking in a mirror, the mirror of the opinion that is projected on the people, misinformed. The question is at this time, do we have statesmen who have the courage to change public opinion rather than follow it? This is especially difficult in an election period in the United States. Let me describe to you the typical situation as I see it in Washington. It's not just in Washington, but look at the people in the Congress who are, in a sense, more divorced from reality than the people on the state level who are closer to the people. What happens, first of all, with a typical congressman in Washington? The typical congressman now, from the time he was last elected, is looking for about $10,000 a day to be accumulated to finance his next re-election campaign. The way he does this is he hires himself a media consultant or similar kind of professional hitman. The media consultant says, I'll get you the vote next election. Fine, we're all set on that. But you got to have money. Doesn't talk about talking to the people, he talks about talking to the money. Now, where is the money today? Who has money? Large amounts of money. It is chiefly the people who are engaged in speculation in Wall Street and elsewhere in the international markets. And these people have an agenda which is based on decrease the capital gains tax and so forth and so on. The general, about the same thing as the Gingrich or Phil Graham type of so-called Republican. So the congressman is told, or any other leading politician, that in order to get the money, the amount of money he requires or he, she requires to be reelected in the 1996 election campaigns, that he must stroke these money sources politically in the manner in which an ant strokes an aphid. If he strokes it just right, then the aphid gives the milk, you know, the sort of ant milk. And thus, the constituency of many congressmen is not their constituents, but rather the money bags that the media consultant tells them to stroke. And the media consultant informs them of what they have to be overheard saying to get the money out of the money bags. And that's why you have a phenomenon such as that referred to by Senator Kennedy in a National Press Club address this past January, where he said, the Democrats have to learn that this country does not need two Republican parties. But that's the way the phenomenon is working. You have a president who has impulses in a good direction. He has some degree of vision, unlike the previous incumbent. He has impulses which are strategic in nature, but he's caught in a political process which is typical, as many of you know, for the United States. A person in elected office has two agendas. The one agenda are those policies which he or she has as a list of objectives to fight to realize. The second agenda is the things with which he or she may or may not agree, which are the things he has to be overheard endorsing, supporting, pushing in order to maintain political relations with certain forces, including the possibility of being reelected. So the president is caught in that position. The difficulty is that we must go against what is apparently prevailing public opinion, to make creative decisions which are demanded by the circumstances, but which are not yet fully understood at this time by the general public. That's real leadership. We have an idea of leadership which has come up recently in the United States, which is contrary to the American tradition. The great American politicians, such as Washington, Hamilton, John Quincy Adams, Abraham Lincoln, and so forth, and Roosevelt in his own way, and Kennedy in his own way. The greater American politicians were people who went out front. As John Kennedy tried to say in a book he wrote called Profiles of Courage. I didn't agree entirely with the book, but the idea was a sound one. The true politician is a leader of the people, not a follower of public opinion. And the true politician has the courage to reshape public opinion. Whereas today, what's needed? You have a bunch of people out there who are suffering, largely. The degree of suffering and poverty and misery and disease and deprivation in this country is worse than ever before. The collapse of the incomes of the American people, the welfare, their family security, their life expectancy since 1968 approximately is horrifying. And as you see, the recent bill which the president has announced he's going to veto, this rescission bill, you see the pure meanness and the murderous savagery in the kinds of policies which are coming down from that quarter at this time. These people are suffering. They have, in reality, as we should know, very little hope of the future if things keep going in the direction they're going. We must save them. We, in a sense, are the captains or the officers of the ship. They are the passengers and the crew. We have a moral responsibility for saving them, for taking the most prudent course of leading them to safety. And since we believe in a republic, we should share with them those ideas, conceptions, and expertise which they need to know to understand what we are doing. Because we depend upon their support and their participation in achieving the result. We have very few such politicians today. The FBI and other institutions have spent recent period trying to eliminate them from public office. There's an estimated approximately 500 African-American political figures who've been targeted by the FBI and related institutions, particularly out of the criminal division, out of Mark Richard's criminal division, in the effort to eliminate the leadership of the African-American section of the population from representation in public life. We see the same mood in what Newt Gingrich has just done with the so-called Black Congressional Caucus. This is this is happening in every stratum of life. We have seen over the past 20 years on, since the changes in the Levy guidelines in 1975, we have seen an increasing emphasis on so-called white-collar crime, which actually amounts to targeting influential people in political or quasi-political public life to eliminate independent voices from the population by intimidating them into ducking under the table rather than take the risk of being themselves targeted under political motivation because they represent not necessarily the right ideas, but they represent a certain degree of independence, of moral and intellectual independence. So we're now asking a president of the United States, in effect, in a period of the worst crisis which we have faced essentially in this century to date, a president who has very little financial support, a president who has very little support within his own party, a party whose officials are by and large thinking more about stroking the money bags to get the money for their re-election campaign than they are about the country and about the people they purport to represent. We're asking this president to stick his neck out and to come to a conclusion which corresponds with the reality of the situation, not with the public opinion polls, not with the received opinion of the lying news media or CNN or Rush Limbaugh. We're asking him to do something which is almost suicidal. Not because we want to cause him to have trouble, but because he's president. And only from the office of the president can the degree of leadership be provided. Echoing what was done in wartime by Franklin Roosevelt and what was done in a short period of his life by President Kennedy. And therefore, it behooves us to think about our responsibilities in this connection, to see to it the president is suitably advised and supported in these matters, as the need may be. Because we can't blame him. We have to blame ourselves. He is our officer. We elected him, or at least he was elected. And he has to do the job. He needs the advice. He needs the support to carry it through, even over the opposition of what is received as public opinion. No. Therefore, we have to worry less about what people say, except from a clinical standpoint, and worry more about what is the truth and what is right. There are people, we see people in this country, like, give me an example of this, just before getting into the economics and such. Let's take the case of the Oklahoma bombing. Now, I'll give you an analogy. A man walks in with a weapon into a 7-Eleven or similar store. The purpose is to perpetrate an armed robbery. In the course of this, he becomes nervous, by the frightened, upset, maybe he's on drugs, by the behavior of some of the people, the innocent bystanders, in the store. At that point, he shoots down a number of these people in a panic. What is the crime? Obviously, it's an armed robbery, in which the murder is a predicate of the armed robbery. If you didn't know who the perpetrator was and he'd escaped, you would investigate the matter on the basis of armed robbery. That's the way you would investigate. Now, what happened in Oklahoma City? Just to give you an example of the kind of problem we have with the news media and with public opinion today. What happened? A bomb went off and destroyed a good deal of the federal building in a rather interesting way from a technical standpoint. If, as the experts have informed me, who've been involved in the investigation, the following information, which I've been authorized to state publicly by them. A scientific analysis of the effect of the blast on that particular structure with its design indicates the following. Although the explosive was apparently the ammonium nitrite oil mixture, akin to what happened with the Port Authority building tower in New York City, that is not the story. An explosive is an explosive. And that's not where you end the investigation. You look at the building and you say, how did this explosive act upon the building? Well, obviously, from the computer and related analysis of the blast effects on that particular building, it was a very sophisticated form of shape charge. The important thing, therefore, is not the choice of explosive. The important thing is the explosive was a component of a shaped charge. Also, if you look at the structure of the building, the vector of the focus of the shaped charge was used to, in a sense, lift some of the stories of the building and drop them. This required the positioning of the vehicle used to carry the shaped charge in an appropriate position. The design of this particular effect involved a degree of skill in planning and designing the event, which was not within the capability of people of the so-called suspect, McVeigh and so forth. Obviously, some accomplice might have been able to drive a truck as a shape charge into the appropriate position which had been indicated to him. But none of the people around of McVeigh's type had the skill to actually design this kind of terrorist act and prepare it. And McVeigh, if he was involved at all, and I'm not passing judgment on that, because I don't know, was only a patsy, an errand boy. Now, what do we have? We have a terrorist act against the United States, an armed robbery, in effect, not the murder of people, not the planting of an explosive. This is, the crime here is not the setting of the explosive, any more than the bullets which killed the people in the armed robbery are the crime. They're a byproduct of the crime. The crime is an act of terrorism against the United States. Now, the people who designed this explosion, on the basis of the considerations which were entered into in shaping the effect of the explosion, the blast, knew what was in the building, including, in this kind of case, they would have known the children were there. Now, no American quasi-terrorist group, except for a lone nut here or there, would conceive of it politically effective to use a terrorist act which destroyed significant numbers of children. So therefore, the militias are not suspect as the architects of this. In the normal sense, no American so-called extremist group is suspect as being the architects of this. This kind of skill involves sophisticated military intelligence skills, not ordinary special forces skills. Then step back and look, all right, somebody operating from a very high level set off an explosion to manipulate the American people politically. Who did it? Who manipulated the American people? Well, who was involved in the manipulation? I could tell you, but I won't now because it's a long story in itself, about the assassination of Mr. Kissinger's designated target, Mr. Aldo Moro, the former Prime Minister of Italy, who was murdered by so-called terrorists in 1978. It wasn't terrorists. The terrorists were used as a front, a deceptive cover, a screen. But if you look at the orchestration of the Italian press and of some elements within the government, prior to, during, and following the Moro incident, you know that it was a certain combination of foreign intelligence agencies, not some bunch of lunatic Red Brigaders who actually executed that act as a political effect. And that Henry Kissinger was involved politically in it, as he was in a number of other killings, as a result of his what he calls his incarnation as a official of government. The same thing here. Who orchestrated, pre-orchestrated, and post-orchestrated the political impact of this terrorist act in Oklahoma upon the American people? Right. The principal person was a fellow called Lord William Rees-Mogg. Lord William Rees-Mogg was former chief editor of the London Times. That is the position of chief publicity agent for a group in London called the Club of the Isles, which is a group of oligarchical financial nobility centered around the British monarchy. Rees-Mogg, together with other elements of that faction of British intelligence, has been for some time, since particularly the end of 1993, has been orchestrating attacks upon the President of the United States, utilizing precisely the forces which British intelligence attempted to inform the American people were behind the Oklahoma bombing. If you look at the Rush Limbaugh knuckle-dragger phenomenon, if you look at the Ambrose Evans Pritchard operation, if you look at the Nichols operation out of Arkansas, which is orchestrated by British intelligence directly, if you look at the operations through the talk shows which are targeting the president, if you look at the people who are running the Whitewater operation from London, the people who are controlling Starr, the special investigator, and so forth and so on. These people who Rees-Mogg and Davidson, the American Taxpayers Union, another one of these neoconservative freaks, indicated were a threat to a conflict with the militias and government before the effect act were assets of Rees-Mogg and his people. The American militia movement has been manipulated and to a large degree taken over as among the American populist right wing by British intelligence, politically. And all of this is easily, fully documented, no speculation, it's all there. Now, before the Terrorist Act, we had a planted story in the United States coming from Lord William Rees-Mogg, together with the supporters, other supporters of Gingrich and Graham, of the Contract on America, and that Contract on America sounds more and more accurate all the time, saying there was going to be a confrontation, a bloody Waco-style confrontation between these groups of people and the U.S. government. This occurred, Rees-Mogg rushed into print with Admirals Evans Pritchard and so forth and said it was these groups which had done the Oklahoma bombing. This goes together with the Aum sect, which is a British intelligence offshoot in Japan. The Aum sect was created in India some years ago by the Dalai Lama. The Dalai Lama has been, for all his adult life, a personal asset of the British monarchy. He is a key official of the World Wildlife Fund. He is also used by British intelligence in its plans to divide China into several parts. The Tibetan angle is part of the propaganda. The British have said openly it is their intention to break up China, post-Deng China, into several component and warring parts for the advantage of the British government. That was the policy against Roosevelt in the 1940s, at which time the British government supported the communists, not because they liked communism, but because they wanted to break up the unification of China. The United States was committed to a unified China. Britain was committed to a dismembered China. And the same thing is true now. The Aum sect, which has just been arrested, I was told they were going to be arrested, and they have been now, figures in this as one of the patsies. It is very closely tied to certain forces in Japan, which are tied to the British faction in Japan. And the event was orchestrated by this. The Dalai Lama now tries to distance himself from his creation, but it is his creation. It's a particular kind of Tibetan Buddhism, which has attached to it a Shiva cult, the Shaiva of the Indian god of death and so forth. So that's there. We are faced with international terrorism, which comes out of a conflict between two systems. The conflict arises, which leads us right back to what this issue is. The conflict that exists today is the same conflict which was reflected in the conflict between Churchill and Roosevelt during the World War II period. And there was a bitter conflict, especially in the Pacific area, but elsewhere. We in the United States represent by heritage a different system than the British do. We represent what our constitutional, federal constitution represents. We represent a commitment to the universal education and to the development of the creative potential of each of our citizens and the expression of this in opportunities for the use of this creative educational development in society, to the benefit of society. The British, as Rees-Mogg has said recently, are committed by tradition to a feudal-like condition in which 95% of the population is virtually uneducated and suppressed, and 5% of the privileged part of the population runs the world. That's the essential conflict. The British represent a tradition of usury. The issues of our war with Britain in the American War of Independence, the War of 1812, the Civil War, which is a British orchestration, our differences with them during the time of McKinley, during the 1890s, our differences with them in the time of Roosevelt's presidency, the fight against Churchill, our differences with them in the time of Kennedy's presidency. These differences are not accidental, personalized differences between members of governments. These are differences between two organically incompatible, opposed systems of government. And these are breaking out now. Today, in recent times, the United States, like every nation in the world today, has been under the domination of a monetary and financial system which we associate with the International Monetary Fund, World Bank, and so forth. This International Monetary Fund is an institution of world government, that is, of the United Nations, officially. It is, in practice, it is a chartered, publicly chartered, private organization, which is a jointly owned and controlled by a group of central banking systems around the world, including our own Federal Reserve System. These central banking systems, like our own Federal Reserve System, are not agencies of government in the proper sense. They are publicly chartered private corporations which are owned by the principal banks and other financial entities of the country. Thus, we are under a dictatorship worldwide in every part of the world of the International Monetary Fund and what it represents. The International Monetary Fund and what it represents is based on a philosophy of government and economics which is British, a philosophy of government and economics which is what we fought against in the War of Independence, in the War of 1812, in the Civil War, and again during World War II and under Kennedy. So what we have today is we have a point where the international financial system, monetary system is disintegrating, and the powerful financial nobility, which calls itself the Club of the Isles, which had gathered around the British monarchy, is losing its power over the world because of the imminent breakdown of the financial system and is resorting to continuation of finance by other means called international terrorism. The event is to eliminate this president, to destroy the United States from within, which is what the package that the nine nations of North America and the other kinds of things, the defederalization of the federal government, the privatization of everything, the breaking up of the United States into several warring parts, all of these kinds of things which are raging storms of ideology among the populace out there, that's the objective. It's an old, evil, oligarchical heritage which is attempting to maintain its grip on this planet in the time of a great crisis. And we in the United States and people in developing countries who aspire to humanity for all of their citizens, the rights of humanity for all of their citizens, find ourselves in a struggle against these international dark forces, as they might be called. This is the case in Mexico, this is the case in Venezuela, this is the case in Peru, this is the case in Brazil, this is the case in Nigeria, this is the case in Sudan, this is the case of virtually dead countries in Africa, this is the case in Eastern Europe, this is the case in China, this is the case in South Asia, this is the case in parts of Western Europe as well. So there's a fight of humanity, of those who believe in the nation state and the idea of the citizen, the rights of the citizen, economic ideas we associate with the citizen, this against an old oligarchical system whose last hiding place, so to speak, its last bastion of power is in the British monarchy. And this thing that happened in Oklahoma, we don't know what the connection is directly between Rees-Mogg and whoever the experts were who designed that explosion in Oklahoma City, but we know the political connection, that this was pre-orchestrated. The terrorist event was situated in a circumstance pre-orchestrated by Rees-Mogg, and it was promptly exploited to somewhat successful effect by the same Rees-Mogg and company who had pre-situated the event. That's the kind of world we live in. We're living in a world where we're fighting for the rights of humanity, we're fighting to avoid a plunge into a dark age, not just a depression, but a dark age. Now, what's the problem? What the president faces and others. The problem is of saying simply, the system is bankrupt, it's rotten, it's axiomatically rotten. We must do to it what we would do to a company which we wanted to keep in business, but which was hopelessly bankrupt. We would put it through Chapter 11. You want to save a company? Well, you would do that. You have to reorganize it. There's no way of saving it under new management. The debts are too high. The prospects of income are too low. The resources are too small. The only thing you can do to save the company is to put it through Chapter 11 bankruptcy reorganization. That's the situation we have worldwide. We cannot liquidate and destroy entire nations because they are bankrupt. That is immoral. Therefore, we have to save the nation and the economy of the nation, no matter what we have to do in writing off financial obligations in order to do so. We declare the Jubilee. So, what we have to do is to immediately not create a vacuum, but immediately, as we would do in the Chapter 11 case, immediately create a new system of credit, a new monetary system, in order to revive the sick economy, and which means putting people back to work, eliminating garbage and waste, creating real jobs, restoring our educational system, maintaining the health system as well as the educational system, which are essential to productivity, and so forth, and rebuild the nations, as nations have done in the wake of wars and terrible disasters before. Rebuild on the basis of the best known, especially the proven principles of economy and society. The only one person who can do that in the world right now is the President of the United States. If the President of the United States were to be able to get by with that in his own country, then I can give you the following. That in Russia, there are many people, influential people, including some of those with whom the President recently met in Moscow, who would welcome and support such a proposal. There are leading people in Ukraine who similarly would welcome and support such a proposal. The government of China, for its own reasons, would welcome such a change. Leading forces in Japan, who are not pro-British, would welcome such a change. Leading people in Africa and South America and Central America would welcome such a change. So the president has a tremendous potential constituency for such action throughout this world at this time. The problem lies chiefly in his own country, where he does not have the kind of support he requires to put this through here. Because if he can put it through here, he can win. And we win. The world wins. And that's the problem. Now, let me just go into some of the technicalities of this. There will appear soon in EIR a longer report on some of the scientific aspects of what I shall say here, or the background to it. But the nature of the subject matter is technical in part, and therefore it requires either the proper audience, or at least it requires the alternative, a written form so people can study and reflect upon it. Some of this material does not go over easily at the first pass in any kind of an oral presentation. It takes some thought and study. But let me give you the highlights. Recently, in my trip to Germany last, we were in touch with an old acquaintance who had been the head of the State Bank of Hamburg, a senator of the German Federal Republic, and also had been an advisor, one of the advisory council of the German Central Bank, the Bundesbank, a fellow Wilhelm Nerling. And he had, as part of his current activities, he teaches a course in Hamburg University, and a group of graduate students who were studying various things, given various graduate student assignments preparatory to the more advanced degrees. And one of the assignments had been given as a study of my work in economics to one of the students. So on hearing that I was in Germany and could be there, he invited me to address this class of his seminar, of his students. So I did that, and I pulled together something which I'll share with you now, which I think is relevant to this point. The way to approach to understand the present world system is to recognize that the present world economy is not a single model of economy, but rather it is a symbiosis or an interaction between two mutually exclusive forms of economy. One, the so-called Adam Smith type, the other, the Leibniz American system type as typified by the economics of Abraham Lincoln or Alexander Hamilton or George Washington. So these two, one system is the monetary and financial system, which sort of sits on top like a parasite or like organized crime coming to get us vigorous every week. And the other system is the real system of real economy in which people produce physical goods, agriculture, manufacturing, construction, infrastructure, and so forth, and also produce science, education, and healthcare, things which are absolutely essential to the development of the population and its productivity. And that's the real economy down underneath there. That's the slave down the cellar that's doing all the work, while the master up there throwing these wild parties, Wall Street parties, is running the monetary and financial command system of the world. These systems are not only different, they are axiomatically opposed. They are as different as different species of beasts in the jungle. They are as different as living systems are from non-living systems, axiomatically. And yet they interact and, in a sense, cohabit, live in a kind of symbiosis. The one system is zero growth, that's the financial monetary system, as I shall indicate. The other system is not entropic, is not zero growth, but is based on the production of what is called a real profit. That is not a profit of enterprise, but an increase in the output of society over what the inputs required to produce that output. In other words, it's a growth system, real economy. The modern economy, let me briefly summarize the case, which is crucial for understanding what's happening to us now. Modern political economy began in the 15th century. There was a form of profit which existed in earlier societies, but it was not the basis for the management of the economy. That began in the 15th century and began officially with the accession of Louis-Onze of France, Louis XI, to become the King of France, who established under his monarchy the first modern nation-state republic, which our American Republic was a continuation of that heritage. This economy was noted under Louis XI for the high rate of growth, such that the national income of France per capita increased by about twice during the 20-odd years of his reign. The key to this development, as to the Renaissance generally, was during the disastrous aftermath of the Black Death in the 14th century, there had sprung up a revival of teaching methods which took boys who were orphans or from poor families at about the secondary level and gave them a very good education on the secondary level of a type we call today classical humanist education, not the secular humanist, but the classical humanist type. They would read and study and copy manuscripts from ancient writings, particularly those which had inclusively scientific interest, including documents which report on original scientific discoveries by ancient people, for example. And the student, instead of simply copying these or learning these in a textbook manner, would be guided to relive the experience of the original discovery. By this kind of education, which was very broad, we call it a classical education, we produced among young people a development of their creative mental potentials. When a child re-experiences an original act of discovery of a valid principle and relives the experience of the original discoverer, that child is called upon to activate those creative mental powers within himself which were employed by the discoverer. And a child whose education is based on that kind of approach, the classical humanist approach, comes out of a secondary educational program with more than learning, so-called, comes out with a sense of how to command, to invoke their own creative mental powers. Now, this was done admittedly on a limited scale. But the results of this kind of education, as by the Brotherhood of the Common Life, which played a very key part in Louis-Onze's France, and similar kinds of teaching programs produced in the 15th century an accumulation of a limited but crucial number of actual geniuses. And the great developments which occurred in that period were not all really new in some ways. The difference was that there was a cadre of young geniuses produced by this kind of secondary education, which had caused the increased rate of proliferation, generation, and assimilation of these kinds of creative ideas. And thus, whereas in previous times the majority of the people, 95% or more, lived as beasts of burden with very little humanity allowed to them, suddenly we had an increase in the percentile of the population which had the best quality of education available. This meant we had a section of the population which was intellectually participating in uplifting the society and participating in use of those kinds of new ideas which led to scientific, technological, and cultural progress, as we associate with the idea of Renaissance. So this development, which was integral in part, in a limited degree, but nonetheless integral to the state policy of the first modern nation state, Louis XI's France, resulted in the production of profit in the real sense. And I'll just indicate what that is in a moment. But one of the reflections of this, between productivity and mobility and firepower in the military domain, there's a certain correlation. So as long as people were organizing wars against one another between states, the state which had the higher rate of scientific and technological and cultural progress would command the relatively greater mobility and firepower. And thus, because of this feature, that when the oligarchical forces tried to crush this form of state, they would find they were up against, as is certain early 16th century writings, including Machiavelli, indicate, they were up against a new form of population and state which could successfully resist this kind of oppression. And thus it was almost impossible for the oligarchy to crush this new kind of institution out of existence, because it was superior per capita, per household, and per square kilometer. Thus we reached, because of failures of the new form of society to assert itself effectively, we reached a kind of symbiosis between two traditions. One, the oligarchical tradition, which had oppressed man in all societies up to that point. An oligarchy which was unwilling to surrender its status, its power, its system. And the new form of society, which is based on the idea that all individuals, all persons, are in the image of God and must be treated and developed accordingly and given expression in society accordingly. So the two systems were in symbiosis. But from that point on, the characteristic feature, functional feature of society, was the production of profit. That is a macro, as we call it today, a macroeconomic profit. That is an increase in the total wealth of society produced, greater than the wealth consumed by that society to produce that wealth. So all theories of modern political economy that had any standing were all based on this idea of profit. Now, the first system of economy was that of the Cameralists, or Leibniz, or Colbert, the system out of which the American system of political economy associated with Alexander Hamilton and Lincoln and so forth came. That's our system. The opposing system came in, to date, four forms, and all of them have a common peculiarity. One of the first opposing systems of political economy, of this second family, was the physiocratic system, which was developed in France in the early 18th century. The physiocrats were sociologically known as, in the 16th century, as the Fronde. The Fronde was feudal, the feudal aristocracy, which was always opposed to the nation state. They were very much like Newt Gingrich. They believed in privatization, no government, no interference of urban society within the private pleasure prerogatives of the feudal aristocracy. They were chronically treasonous and always Anglophiliac. They're nasty people. There was a fellow who was a representative of this tendency by the name of Dr. Quesnay, Francois Quesnay, who is a court physician and who became an ideologue who created the physiocratic system. Now, what he said is, effectively, there is no profit created by modern society. The idea that urban society and technological progress and so forth create profit is not true. He argued that profit is a product of the bounty of nature. That nature always produces profit, like an aphid produces milk for the ants. You stroke it and you get profit. He said the profit is, however, is not produced, it's produced by relations of nature, such as agriculture and mining. But then he said, but the peasants don't produce the bounty. It's not the farmers or miners who produce the wealth. They are only like cattle. And they have no more relationship to the production of wealth than your cows and your sheep and so forth do. You feed them, you care for them, but you don't share your profit with them. They're only cattle, after all. Human cattle. No, the profit belongs to nature. But who has a right to the profit? Ah, he said. God has, in his wisdom, has given title to the land areas of nature to the feudal aristocracy. Therefore, the profit of society belongs to the aristocrat. That's the physiocratic system. To complete the picture, Quesnay invented a doctrine called laissez-faire, which is sort of a Newt Gingrich doctrine. The state must not interfere with the pleasure of the feudal aristocrat. The urban society must not interfere with the pleasure and profit-seeking of the feudal aristocrat. Laissez-faire. The second system was produced, was based as a plagiarism, in part, of Quesnay's physiocratic system. This was the system of Adam Smith and company, otherwise known as the British East India Company. Adam Smith plagiarized, most of his work is based on a plagiarism of both Quesnay and another physiocrat by the name of Turgot, that is Wealth of Nations. Adam Smith, however, made a change. He said, yes, it is not labor that produces wealth, it is the bounty of trade. So he shifted the owner of wealth from the feudal aristocrat to the financier nobility of the Venetian type, which had taken over London at that time. And the British feudal aristocrats, of course, were being assimilated into the financier nobility and were no longer feudal aristocrats in the feudal sense. He also, this idea of laissez-faire and of free trade is based on an outrightly, explicitly evil teaching. It's a belief in evil, which we can trace from Galileo. We can trace it explicitly from Thomas Hobbes, who was a student of Galileo and the putative wife of Francis Bacon, from John Locke, who copied the work of Locke with some changes, and so forth. And also from this fellow called Bernard Mandeville, who wrote in the 1725, I believe it was, The Fable of the Bees, which has subtitled Private Vices, Public Benefits. The idea of these people was, it's the idea of radical liberalism, of British liberalism. We must not judge what is moral or scientifically valid in the preferences of one person or another for this kind of action or object. We must recognize, as Hobbes attempted to show based on the influence of Galileo, that it is the interaction of evil motives and impulses, which are the characteristic of human nature, is to be evil. That the interaction of these evil impulses and actions, such as drug pushing, as was insisted by both, not only Milton Friedman, but also by Adam Smith before him, that these impulses, through their interaction, lead through a kind of chaos theory, as we'd call it today, into a benefit, which Locke called a social contract. Rousseau and others, the same kind of thing. That the interaction of evil produces good. That is the doctrine of laissez-faire, that is the doctrine of free trade, that is the doctrine of chaos theory. Then Marx came along and based himself on both Quesnay and Adam Smith and produced another variety of the same doctrine. Now the doctrine is this, that profit is not produced by any intelligible process, but rather is produced as an epiphenomenon of some object or event. In other words, the physiocrat claimed that the bounty of nature, profit, was a secretion, an epiphenomenal secretion in some mysterious way of the landlord's title to land. The Adam Smith said, there is no intelligible explanation of how profit is produced, except that as the bounty of trade. That is the frictional interaction among evil-doing free traders in their peculiar sexual and other practices leads to a good, asymptotically. And this is profit. Karl Marx said, no, you guys are wrong. The profit comes from the sweat of the laborer, not from the intellect of the laborer. He denied that, but from the sweat of the laborer, mysteriously. We have today a fourth version of this idiocy, which is called the third brainwave of Alvin Toffler and Newt Gingrich and company. They insist that the source of profit is chaos, information theory, which is to say, again, evil doing by the individual, interacting with the evil doing by other individuals, results asymptotically through chaos in the production of a good, a social contract. And that is the meaning in the algebra of Newt Gingrich for his draft of Contract with America. That the evil impulses of greed of the people against the government and against each other means we must maximize by privatizing everything to let evil do its good work. That's what we're up against. We're up against insanity. Now, what is, in each of these cases, what does it amount to? In the case of the physiocrats, they argued for a dictatorship of the feudal aristocratic class. In the case of Adam Smith, who was a hired agent, a propaganda agent, for the British East India Company, the argument was the world must be ruled by the merchant financier class as a political class. Marx copied them quite faithfully in saying the world must be ruled by a dictatorship of the proletariat. Lord William Rees-Mogg, a chief international sponsor of Newt Gingrich, says the objective is to have the world ruled by less than 5% of the population who are the information class. That's what the problem is, these ideas, as against the idea that every individual is in the image of God, and that we can understand in some way how profit is produced, that there is a difference between good and evil. There's a difference between what is right and wrong scientifically, that we have the intelligence to discover that, to know that, and to be guided by acting accordingly. That's what the essential conflict is here. So what we have is a conflict between two systems. The system of the Kenney, Adam Smith, Karl Marx, and Newt Gingrich variety, information society variety, against the system which is, in our history, is the American system of political economy, which is based on the education, universal education, of every child, to educate not how to behave, but to educate them into their moral and creative potentialities, and to order society in such a way that as they become adults, we create the opportunities for the suitable expression to the benefit of mankind in an intelligible way of those creative potentialities. This means that a certain standard of living is required. You can't have an educated population if you have a life expectancy modally to 40 to 50 years of age. You cannot support people going to school to levels of up the graduating levels of 18 to 25 and having their parents die off at the age of 40. Can't be done. You have to have a longer lived population. You cannot have a high infant mortality rate. You cannot have impaired health, high incidence of impaired health. You have to have a well cared for, well fed, healthy population, well educated. From this education and from these skills come the opportunities to express themselves in ways which they know are useful to society. In this country, we used to have the moral standard, particularly among the immigrants, would say, well, I'm sacrificing. And they were sacrificing. In my time, when I was young, I met many of these people who came in as immigrants. They were the parents or the grandparents of my friends, of my peer group. They had come into this country off the boat, often poor, had worked, sacrificed, to provide their children an education. And those children with that education and with that little boost in getting off the ground had gone on, and they had had children. And their children had moved up, as they used to say. And the parents who had suffered, who had the scars and pains of their sacrifice and labor, visible in their bones and flesh, in their infirmities, were joyous about the achievement of their grandchildren, their children. And that was as a moral commitment, that we each live in a sense that we're making a contribution not merely to our progeny and to our descendants, but we're making a contribution to the society, this nation, and that we hope that we have a nation in which we can take pride because it, as a nation, is making a vital contribution to the condition of civilization around the world. Therefore, we have this conflict. We have a system, which is the Adam Smith system, so to speak, the Kinney, Adam Smith, Karl Marx, and Gingrich system, which is sucking the blood out of us globally, which has destroyed most of black Africa. There's very little of it left. Aside, you'll hear more of it later, but we're discussing it the other day. Some of our friends just came back from Nigeria, which is what, 1/4 of the population of all Africa, black Africa, which is the principal source of the African-American population of the United States today, and which represents about 1/5 of the total African population of the world. And all of Africa, except for Sudan, to some degree South Africa, and Nigeria, is currently being destroyed in the sense of mass murder or genocide by the kinds of policies which are represented by those who support Adam Smith, Kinney, Marx, and Newt Gingrich, and the International Monetary Fund. The International Monetary Fund and World Bank are committing genocide and mass murder in Africa, throughout Africa, in most of Central and South America, in other parts of the world. They are committing murder just as much as if the individual members of the IMF took clubs or axes and went out and crushed the skulls of that number of people who die as a result of the actuarially foreseeable consequences of IMF policies. We are dominated by evil, which does not believe in profit, not real profit, does not believe in the development of the creative powers and productive powers of labor to improve the conditions of life, does not believe that the individual has a right to a sense of moral purpose in their brief mortal existence, in contributing not only to their family but to the nation, a sense of pride and patriotism of the nation because of the vital contribution it makes to the welfare of civilization as a whole. And like we used to say, the United States has a mission in the world. Now, Gingrich says we don't. Right. And that's the issue. So, we have to free ourselves intellectually from the teachings of those who tell us that the secrets of economy are to be found in the worship of the doctrines of Kinney, Adam Smith, Marx, and similar people. That's what's killing us as a nation. If we as a people recognized the principles of political economy upon which modern European civilization is based, if we recognize the principles of political economy which caused this nation before 1963, despite all our errors and so forth, to become the most powerful economy on this planet. And if we applied that knowledge to our present circumstances, we would say, get about it. We've made a mistake. We've drifted from the truth. Let's get back to it. Let's take the measures which are necessary. We have bankruptcy all the time. We have Chapter 11 all the time. My cousin just went through it, and so on and so on. You say those kinds of things, huh? Say, well, why don't these bankrupt governments? Why don't the British, they're bankrupt. Their ideas are bankrupt. Why don't they go into bankruptcy like anybody else? Why doesn't the IMF go into bankruptcy like anybody else? Why isn't the World Bank going into bankruptcy like anybody else? Why doesn't Rockefeller finally go into the bankruptcy he so richly deserves? Why do the rest of us have to suffer? Why does humanity have to suffer and be oppressed? Why don't we simply do what we would do in any ordinary situation? The system is bankrupt. Let's admit it's bankrupt, put it into bankruptcy reorganization, and go back to the proven principles upon which the success of economy was based. So our enemy lies within us. The enemy is without us, but the enemy is also within us. To the extent that we and the American people have succumbed to belief that they, this indefinite pronoun they, that they somehow know what is best for us, that they have the wisdom which we must obediently follow, and we can't do anything about it. Let me just finally end on one note, which with deference to my wife's contributions to these things. Let's take the case of one of the most evil men of the 20th century. Not Adolf Hitler, but a close second. Maybe did more damage. Martin Heidegger, who was also a Nazi, a full Nazi without any qualification, who helped to give us such things as liberation theology, among other things, as well as Nazism. But the doctrine of all of these existentialists, who were very close to the Nazis in their theology, including Jean-Paul Sartre, who implicitly is a French Nazi, who couldn't find his swastika prasad at the right time. What do these people say about man in society? Like Nietzsche, and like the other pessimists, like Schopenhauer. What do they say about man? They say man is thrown into society as an individual, as into a jungle. That man has no participation in society, that the individual is not responsible for the society as a whole, as not morally or intellectually responsible for what happens to society. We are supposed to believe differently in this country. We are supposed to believe that we are each citizens, that although we may, in a sense, alienate our authority by electing representatives with delegated authorities, that nonetheless we are participating in the activities of our appointed self-government. That we participate in other ways in the moral development, the spiritual development, the material development of our country. That we are not things thrown into this society as creatures suddenly thrown into a jungle, but we are part of it. We are organic. We have creative powers. We can assimilate ideas. We can act upon ideas. We can create new ideas. That we have a sense of responsibility. That when we look at the United States out at the world, we see the oppression as I saw it during the war, in India, in Burma, of the British Empire. When we see the oppression, not only in our own country, but below our borders, or in Africa, or in other parts of Asia, or in Eastern Europe, we say this is wrong. We can do something about it. We, as individuals, through our participation in our society and our government. We have to therefore understand the principles, the right principle which should guide us in our guiding our processes of self-government. And once we get those ideas into our head and no longer believe we are compelled to obey those wiser heads at universities who teach this bunkum, who sell us the used cars without motors, these people, and take the moral and intellectual responsibility ourselves for discovering to the best of our ability what the truth is, and then saying we are going to act as individuals, through our institutions, to bring about those changes which make sense, which address the problems before us. Thank you.